Back in the day, the law school professor would create an exam where he'd weave together a story that would exemplify each of the issues in that area of the law. But never did the professor do it as good a job as the GameStop saga, which identifies most of the issues facing our capital markets. Short selling. Could there be limits or required additional disclosures? What do we do with market participants who are shorting or buying a stock for the purpose of influencing its price?
When our research suggests a company will not live up to expectations and its stock price is overvalued, we might short a stock. Our practice is to short a stock for the long term, because when the markets go down, we have a duty to protect our investors' capital.
While I understand that short selling can be used for legitimate purposes, too often I have seen abuse and it ends up harming ordinary workers and families. And now we are seeing it here against GameStop. Large investors have to disclose their long positions when they own 5% or more of the company's shares, but not such disclosure is required for short positions.
If you're short selling a stock 140%, explain to me why that's not manipulating a stock.
Anytime we short a stock, we locate a borrow. Our systems actually force us to find a borrower. So we always, you know, short stocks within the context of all the rules.
Don't you think there should be a limit on something like that?
I believe that the short interest in GameStop was exceptional. Every bank, every hedge fund does have to comply with the requirement to borrow shares to short shares in the course of their day in and day out business. The practice of naked shorting was largely curtailed by SEC mandate. 8 years ago.
How did you come up with your name for the company?
Robinhood stands for lowering the barrier to entry and democratizing finance for all. So the idea is the same tools that institutions and wealthier high net worth individuals have had for a long time should be available to the people regardless of their net worth or how much money they have.
What is this payment for order flow model?
Citadel Securities pays Robinhood tens of millions of dollars to process trades by Robinhood's customers.
When you're not paying for it, it's not free. You're the product. Someone else is the customer. There are two ways to pay the folks involved in Wall Street for buying and selling stock. One is a commission. The other way to do it is to give them a worse execution. Whenever there's a stock being purchased and sold, the market maker might be willing to sell the stock for $10.05, but will buy it for only $10. The difference is 5 cents. And so the issue is whether Robinhood and other people who are being told you get it for free are really getting it for free. Mr. Griffin, you're a market maker. You pay some brokers for order flow. You don't pay others for order flow. When you pay for order flow, you're not making as much on the transaction. You have to pay some of that back to the broker. The amount of that is hidden from the customer. And what does it mean when some participants get best execution and some get enhanced best execution?
In December 2020, the SEC charged Robinhood for not disclosing that it was getting paid to send customer trades to Citadel Securities and for not seeking the best terms for its customers' orders. Robinhood provided such inferior trade prices it cost your customers over $34 million. Is your testimony after Robinhood paid the SEC $65 million to settle those charges that this conflict of interest is in your customers' best interest? Yes or no?
We've made mistakes in the past. I'm not claiming that.
Yes or no to that question.
So Citadel Securities is an important counterparty. Nobody's denying that. The reason that...
Gentlemen, can answer yes or no? I'm reclaiming my time.
Are all traders being treated fairly?
This relationship gives Citadel Enterprise key non-public information as to direction and volume of trades by retail investors.
And is payment for order flow free to the consumer?
Is payment for order flow legal?
Yes, payment for order flow is legal.
And is this disclosed to those users of your app?
Yes, payment for order flow is disclosed in multiple places. And moreover, payment for order flow enables commission-free trading. And that's why it's become the industry standard model, as other brokerages have replicated our model.
SEC rules require that people get the best execution, but I've recently learned that there's best execution and enhanced pricing. So if you get an order from Fidelity and you get an order from Robinhood, and you're paying for the Robinhood order flow, is the Robinhood customer getting as good a price as the Fidelity customer?
The execution quality that we can provide as measured in terms of price improvement is heavily related or correlated to the size of the order that we receive. If I were to speculate,
Don't tell me that that there are other factors involved and take us down another road. I'm asking you a clear question. Assuming same size of order, one comes in from Robinhood, one comes in from Fidelity. Is it not true that one is going to get a enhanced best execution and the other one is just going to get best execution?
Because the Robinhood order comes from a community of traders who tend to trade in smaller size.
That isn't my question, sir. You're evading my question by making up other questions. Let me repeat. Two identical orders come in. Same stock, same quantity. One's from Robinhood, one's from Fidelity. What happens?
The quality of the execution varies by the channel of the order. This is a commonly understood phenomenon in economics that channels matter.
Okay, reclaiming my time, sir. Who gets the better deal? The one that comes from a broker who is being paid for order flow and one not. Can you testify that that on balance, there is no difference? Assuming the same size of the order.
So as I said earlier, size of the order is only one factor.
You are doing a great job of wasting my time. If you're going to filibuster, you should run for the Senate. Everyone else I've talked to in this industry says when your broker is being paid for order flow, you get a worse execution.
If a market maker trades improperly ahead of the own customer accounts, he can get a better price and can move the market in the process depending on how big the trade is, thus hurting the customer.
If this trade is huge, and you can see that the client is huge and will have an impact on the market, how does that benefit the market maker to trade ahead of the client?
The market maker can get a better price for himself before the price changes by the client's trade. He can also engage in self-dealing that way as well. I think disclosure can always be better. And I think people should understand that their broker still needs to make money, even if they're providing a zero commission trading service.
The market maker Citadel traded over-the-counter stocks for its own accounts from 2012 to 2014 while simultaneously delaying client orders for the same shares. And it was fine for this. Citadel has been naughty for some time. 2014, Citadel faced $800,000 in penalties. 2017, $22.6 million. 2018, $3.5 million. 2020, $97 million. And another 2020 of $700,000. This seems like a lot of money. It is for me, more than $124 million. But over the same period of time, Citadel had revenues generated in the amount of $13.2 billion. It seems to me that the punishment for these improper trades and improper actions, because it wasn't just trading, Citadel also did some other things that were not proper. They misled clients. Seems that the punishment is so small given the amount of revenue generated over the same period of time. It seems that Citadel has at least an opportunity to build into its cost of doing business paying penalties. It concerns me that the punishment doesn't seem to deter Citadel. It concerns me because I know of circumstances where in persons who are not in the market, they do things that are much less harmful and they can possibly go to jail. So the question that I have is this: what kinds of systems do we have in place to prevent the very things that I have called to the attention of my colleagues?
Well, as a former enforcement attorney at FINRA, I can say that regulators have the same concern with fines and other punishments becoming just a cost of doing business. And it's one of the things that are considered along with the regulations around what can be punished.
Why did Robinhood restrict the buying but not the selling of GameStop? And why did folks get locked out on the buy side only?
The decision to restrict GameStop and other securities was driven purely by deposit and collateral requirements imposed by our clearinghouses. Buying securities increases our collateral requirements. Selling does not. Moreover, preventing customers from selling where customers are unable to access their money. So I imagine it would have been significantly worse if we prevented customers from selling.
Let's be crystal clear. that decision you made to restrict the buying but not the selling of GameStop, was it based on pressure from anyone on the witness panel here today?
Not at all. Zero pressure from anyone. It was a collateral depository requirement decision made by our Robinhood Securities president.
We had no role in Robinhood's decision to limit trading in GameStop or any of the other meme stocks.
Your firm makes use of private exchanges called dark pools to trade large sizes without moving the market against you. In fact, your business strategy is designed intentionally to undermine market transparency and skim profits from companies and other investors. One problem though, Mr. Griffin, is that we don't really know how central your firm has become to the capital markets. Mr. Griffin, does Citadel handle 47% of the U.S. listed retail volume? Please, yes or no.
So, Chairman Waters, to the best
of my knowledge.
Yes or no? So, best of my knowledge, we handle in excess of roughly 40% of all retail volume.
Thank you very much for reclaiming my time.
We need to look at the plumbing where it takes 2 days to settle a transaction.
The existing two-day period to settle trades exposes investors and the industry to unnecessary risk. There is no reason why the greatest financial system in the world cannot settle trades in real time.
Why is it the broker's capital rather than the customer's capital that is posted during the two-day period? And finally, we need to look at the gamification and glorification of high-frequency trading.
The whole enterprise was viewed by some as a giant video game, trading stocks instead of properties and monopoly money.
It's alarming how little we know about the inner workings of the market, and I am thankful that this committee is examining what happened.